Hi everyone. In today's video, I want to go through multithreading within Java. All that multithreading is having your program deal with multiple threads, where a thread is a continuous set of code that you are running, or a task is kind of how you could think of it. Typically in the programs we've worked on so far, we've had a single thread doing all of our work. Now what we're going to do is we're going to demonstrate what happens if you add multiple threads, so that instead of doing serial processing, you can do what's called concurrent processing. Let's pull up IntelliJ and take a look. Today's project we'll call threading. So now we have our code up, let's go ahead and make some threads. You can do that in two different ways in Java. The first way is making an instance of a thread, and the second way is making an instance of a runnable. A runnable is an interface, a thread is a class. So when you think about which one you want to do, you want to be thinking about whether your class needs to also extend other classes or if it just needs to extend one class. I'll go into examples of both and kind of show the differences. First, let's do an example of extending thread. Let's create a new class. We'll call it custom thread. And we'll make sure that it extends the thread class. And the next thing we're going to do is we're going to override the run method. And now what we do in here is within the run method, this is where you want your actual thread code to work. So to start, I'm just going to say in my thread. And what we're going to do is we're going to have this thread actually do some work. So just like we always do, let's make an instance. And then you would think that you would want to do thread1.run. But you don't actually want to do that. You want to call the start method on your thread. That's a small little difference. The run method is what executes your task, and the start method is what kicks off your thread so that it's actually its own thread. So to differentiate those two things, let me add a little more code. What I'm going to do is I'm going to, in my main method, I'm going to add a sleep, which means that the main thread, which is what we've always been working with previously, is going to wait a certain amount of time. That's going to be shorter than the amount of time that we're going to have our new thread wait. And I'll demonstrate whether I'm kicking off a new thread or not via the waits that I'm doing in my main thread. Now we have the code here, I'll talk through it a little bit. We're starting a new thread, and then we are sleeping on what we call our main thread, which is the thread that we normally do most of our execution on. And then after we're done sleeping, then we print out this message. This 500 is 500 milliseconds, so half a second. And then in our custom thread, what we're doing is we print out when we enter the run method, and then we print out when we exit it, and between there, we're sleeping for a whole second. So what this should do, if my threads are executing concurrently, is while this main thread is sleeping for the 500 milliseconds, I should be getting a printout that I am running within the run method here, and then I should get a printout afterward that I have been done sleeping, but that's going to happen after the main thread is done. So let's go ahead and run the code and see what it does. All right, interesting. So we call the start method. That brings us into run within a new thread. We are at the start of our run method here. And then now we're sleeping for a whole second. So then we switch back to our main thread and we sleep for only half of that time, and then we print out the new value. Now if I switch this over to run, we will see how the behavior changes. You see the subtle difference? This time the run method gets called. So we are sleeping the whole duration of this second, and we're printing out done sleeping in second thread before we even hit the main thread here. So that's an important distinction to understand. When you're overwriting thread, you got to make sure to call start, not run, like what you would normally think you would do. So now we've demonstrated that, the next thing I want to do is I want to update my custom thread class to take a string argument, which will help determine which thread is printing some information. And I'm going to make three threads. One is going to print information for cat, one for dog, and one for bird. And I'm going to show concurrent processing with three different threads. All right, so what this code is doing is it's creating three custom thread objects, each with a different tag on it, which I'll go into what that is in a second. And then I'm starting all of them. The tag here is just a string, and I am putting that string in this print line, and then I'm sleeping 1 second each time. So let's go ahead and run the code and demonstrate what happens when you have multiple concurrent threads all executing at the same time. All right, here it's executing. We can see we hit 1, 2, 3, and then our program exits. So the first thing you'll notice is that we have cat, bird, dog, which is slightly different from the order that we have here. And then after that, we have bird, cat, dog. So you can see here that the printing changes order based off of which iteration we're looking at here. And that's another interesting thing about multithreading is that timing between threads is not necessarily deterministic. So whenever you write your programs, you got to make sure that you are careful to think about if you expect your threads to execute in a certain order. That goes into a whole nother set of code and protections you can do that I'll go into in a future video. But the point being is that concurrency is something where guaranteed timing requires a lot of extra defensive coding. Another useful method within the thread class is the join method. The join method basically says, I want you to halt the current thread's execution until the thread that I'm calling join on finishes. So what does that mean? Well, if I were to print out done right here within my main thread and I execute this code, you'll see that my main thread is done before any of the other threads are done. I called done right here, but the other three threads that I fired off are still going. So if I want to guarantee that my main thread finishes last after these other three threads, then what I have to do is I have to do some additional processing. One way to do that is to wait until all three of them join. Now if we run the code again, we'll see here that the done happens at the end after each of the joins return. So I mentioned there are two ways to have threads within Java. One is overriding the thread class and the other one is implementing the runnable interface. Now I'm going to demonstrate what happens when you are working with runnables. The difference with runnable is that you have to submit runnable as a task to another class or another executor of some sort in order to actually create your thread. It's a small difference, but there are a few semantics, so I'm going to go ahead and convert my custom thread into a custom runnable and show you what that looks like. Okay, so this gets at what I was talking about earlier. When you have a runnable, you're creating a subclass of the runnable interface. And what you have to do is you have to wrap your runnable with something that can manage a thread that executes your runnable. So in this case, what I'm doing is I'm creating a new thread and constructing it with the runnable task and then calling start on it. So in this case, I'm still using the thread class, but instead of overwriting the run method within the thread class, I am passing in a runnable. I'll go ahead and show this code working. And as you can see, we get similar output that we did last time where we're using a runnable rather than a thread. The main benefit of runnable over thread is that if you want your class to extend other things and also be able to be a runnable task in a thread, you can just implement the runnable interface because multiple interfaces can be implemented, whereas you can only extend one class. If all you need to do is make your class act like a thread and that's all it has to do, extending thread might be your best option. It kind of just depends on the situation. So next one I want to do is I want to demonstrate the executor service within Java. I'm going to refactor my code a little bit to clean this up, and I'm going to use the executor service in order to manage my runnables. All right, so this code's a little different. What I have here is an executor service, and I'm making a new fixed thread pool. So what this is saying is I want to allocate a certain number of threads associated with my executor service. In this case, I have three threads, and I'm iterating over all the threads that I want to have, and I'm creating a new custom runnable for each of them, and I am submitting the runnable to the executor, which what that does is it creates a thread and associates the runnable with it and then starts it. Let's go ahead and show what this code's doing. Okay, so we can see that we're looping over each of our threads here, but now you'll notice I'm just sitting here. Nothing's happening. Uh-oh, what did we do? Our program's hanging. Okay, we got to go ahead and kill this and let's fix it. So a very important thing to do with executor service is you have to shut down the executor service when you know you're done with it. Just like how you have to close your resources with file IO, you want to shut it down when you know you're done with it. So I'll demonstrate how that works here. So as you'll see in this case, we're running the code, and when all the threads are done, we are actually exiting correctly because we hit the shutdown method. Sweet. So that's an important difference. You got to have the shutdown method, and you got to make sure that your executor is no longer taking any new tasks, and you do that via the shutdown method. A nice little thing that was added in Java 19 is that the executor service now implements auto closable, which means that I can wrap this in a try with resources. So I'll go ahead and rewrite the code to do that next. And while I'm at it, this is getting to be a long line of code, and I know I'm dealing with an executor service, so I'm just going to call that var. All right. So now if I run this, we're doing the same thing we were before, where we're iterating over the loop. And then here at the end, we exit our program. Sweet. So this is a pretty slick way to be able to manage threads. And one thing you'll often find in production code is that people use things like an executor service a lot more than dealing with thread directly. And the reason for that is because these utility APIs are there for a reason, and they make your code a lot easier to read and a lot easier to understand and maintain, rather than you needing to have custom code to handle individual threads all the time. It's a lot easier to use an API that handles some of that for you. And that was an introduction to multithreading within Java, where we talked about thread versus runnable, as well as how you can manage threads and runnables via the executor service, and the things you can expect out of concurrent programming as far as non-determinism when you're talking about certain threads executing at certain times. Getting good at concurrent programming is a bit of an arduous, but honestly, very rewarding journey. With that, I think I'm going to wrap up today's video. Thank you all for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.